All right, for days now, lawmakers have said they're closing in on a COVID relief deal. Sounds a hell of a lot like the brinkmanship we have to deal with every time, right? Even in a crisis, even with people hungry. Now, they had hope. Why? Well, because the shutdown deadline that loomed tonight would kind of force them to do something. But for the second time in 2 weeks, they've passed what's called a stopgap measure, meaning they just bought themselves a little bit more time so they can keep talking, which is means not getting it done, right? I want to bring in Democratic Senator Joe Manchin. He's been spearheading these bipartisan efforts. Welcome back to primetime. I know you're busy. I know you're tired. Thank you for keeping my my audience in the loop. And Senator, my suspicion about this, that it does feel like the ordinary brinkmanship of, well, getting down to the wire. You know, it's about to end. I don't know if we're going to make a deal. I hope we do. Even with people hungry in the streets all over America, we're playing the same game?
Let me say this, Chris. First, it's always good to be on with you and always. Keep all the people apprised and the transparency that they should have. And first of all, let me just show you. See this bill? This bill that we worked on in a bipartisan, bicameral way was delivered on Monday. This is a template of what should be put together and how we take care of the emergency needs of America. It's just an emergency till April 1. Well, it's turned over to the four corners. Now, when the four corners get it, that's the leadership in both the House and the Senate. And then you have them regurgitating everything. Maybe what they didn't want in or what they wanted in or what someone else has encouraged them to do. And they start finicking with it, if you will. So you got four different staffs going at it. Now, these staffs haven't gotten along that well over the period of time because it always comes to the end. Let me tell you why it always comes to the end. It comes to the end in a deadline because it takes all of us out. It takes a majority of 100 senators out of play completely and left into the hands of a few. And that makes it almost impossible for us to have any input. So we delivered this on Monday. This was a package that was put together by Democrats and Republicans, and we were hoping that this was the template. Now, Chuck Schumer and the Democrats have used this as a template, and I appreciate that very much. But for some reason, they've gone off in so many different areas. The federal crisis response powers is what's holding everything up right now. And I'm begging and pleading with my Republican friends, my Republican senator friends, and Mitch McConnell, the majority leader for the Republicans, I'm pleading, please. This is not the place for that. It truly is politics. This has been in place since 2008 when we had the financial crisis. Now, all of a sudden, it comes in play. It's been in play for 12 years to where the Federal Reserve has the ability to infuse into the markets when needed to keep the market from collapsing and emergencies from happening. Why all of a sudden? Because we have a change of an administration, President-elect Joe Biden going in, now it becomes a big deal. If you want to take this out, if you want to do this and talk about it, Chris, let's wait until April after we get through our first quarter. This is strictly an emergency.
But what's their upside?
This is not a do-all, end-all.
Why does McConnell want to get rid of that? And do plain speak for me. What is that mechanism? Why was it in place to help the markets? We know that was from 2000 to 2009. Why does he want that out? And why is he asking for it now? What's his basis?
Well, I don't know, unless it's just pure politics. It would take a tool away from the Federal Reserve with the Biden administration going in. There's nothing the Biden administration would do any different than what's been done under
but
the
what does
Trump
it have to do with the pandemic?
Or the Obama administration. Has nothing to do with the pandemic. If anything, it'll help the feds preserve a collapse. But I can't figure it out why this has come in. If that could be done away with, I guarantee you, by tomorrow morning, we'd have a deal.
So
I think it's ready to be done.
I never even heard of this before.
Ironed everything
out. When did they ask for this?
This has been happening for the last 3 or 4 days. It came into play. We heard about it 2 days ago. Never thought, because it had nothing to do with any discussions any of us ever had, Chris. And all of a sudden, I'm hearing, this is the thing. This is what's holding us up now. They want this out. And I said, why now? What has the feds done wrong? What have they abused? It's a tool that keeps the market from collapsing. It allows the Fed to inject, if need be. And that's all we've asked for. And that's what's been there since 2008. How come all of a sudden now, Chris?
I don't know. You tell me.
How come all of a sudden now?
I mean, I thought he was worried about what was going to happen in Georgia, and they wanted to get a bill done before Christmas. Why would he put something in that would blow it up?
I'm just saying, if someone has been basically misinformed, I'm begging my friends. We're asking for a relief package, an emergency relief package, that the United States of America, my state of West Virginia, all the states need help. We're talking about shelter, we're talking about food, we're talking about unemployment assistance, we're talking about financial assistance, basically for businesses that aren't going to make it.
So it's not the liability waiver anymore, it's not the you don't get state and local funding?
That's gone. Liability's gone.
And is it, it's
not? That's gone. Those
state and local?
Yeah, it's not. We knew it was, you know, state and local liability was a big hangup, right? That's why we separated it, Chris. Now they want to do direct payments. Well, at first they were going to take money away from the people that had none. So this has been a big thing. You've been seeing some of my Senate colleagues on the floor raising Cain about why they had to have more money, direct payments. Everybody wants to get a check. But don't you think it's an emergency and a crisis if you're going to lose your unemployment?
Yeah.
To feed your family and keep a roof over your head? That's the unemployment emergency we're dealing with. But nope, they have to send checks out. I said, I'm all for it. But in an emergency, can't we come back when basically the first of the year and see what it takes to stimulate the market and send checks then if that really is what it takes? I just can't figure this out. How these priorities, you know, makes no sense. We dealt strictly, and I'll tell you again, strictly, all we dealt with was the emergencies. And now they've thrown everything in, and now on top of that, to say, well, we got to get rid of the federal crisis response powers because that's harming. What is it harming? It gives the Federal Reserve the ability
to keep
the markets from collapsing, and we're still in a pandemic. Has nothing to do with it. So I'm asking everybody, if you want a bill and get it done, call our Republican friends, please. These are all good people. There's some reason that's got everybody ticked off. Makes no sense at all. But please call them. Please say, hey, put that off till February or March. Fight about it then. Let this package go. That's all we're asking for.
So it's not even that the Democrats are holding out for the $1,200 checks, and that's what the tension is. You're saying the new point of tension is something that has nothing to do with the pandemic.
That's it, brother. That is, I can't tell any clearer than that, Chris.
And did it come from McConnell, or is it just appeared?
It came from one of the senators, one of my friends that we did a bill together. He's still my friend. I don't know why he's all fired up. I really don't. And I guess if Mitch McConnell can shut it down, said we're not going to do it now. We'll do it later.
Let me ask you something.
So if they're using that for a tool to trade back and forth, makes no sense.
You know, people who don't know your history in your state, you and I first met during a mine disaster.
Yes, we did.
And I watched you out there deal with people who were angry and they were scared and they were given bad information and false hope, and you kept people calm and settled. And that was the hope, that you would go to Washington. And I remember when you went in there, I was like, well, this guy can deal with bad situations. I watched it in real time. But you never expected anything like this. These people, they're people hungry in the streets, and a guy that you'll say is still your friend is putting something in that may keep them hungry through Christmas?
I think maybe, I don't know, buddy. I swear to God, I can't explain it to you, Chris. This is beyond me how anyone could think that this is so important that if you don't do this, we're going to hold this up and not send out $800 or $900 billion that'll keep the economy alive, but more importantly, it'll keep a lot of people alive. And that's and I cannot believe this has become that important. But this is where it's at as of today. And you told me to come back and give you an update on what's happening. I'm giving it to you to the minute.
I will never tell you to do anything. You're too powerful and you're too large. But I will always ask you and invite you. And I do have a bottle of the best tequila that I'm not allowed to drink anymore. And it's coming your way for keeping your promise. Senator Joe Manchin, thank you very much.
No. Well, thanks, Chris. Hey, Merry Christmas if I don't talk to you before, and your family. Please enjoy each other. If you can count your blessings, you can share your blessings.
Amen. Amen, and thank you, Senator. And I'll be talking to you.